Hello, and welcome to the National Human Genome Research Institute's fourth event in our Genomics and the Media series. My name is Sarah Bates. I'm the Communications Chief for NHGRI. I'm very excited today to introduce our distinguished guest for today's event. The topic, how media and language can help fight scientific racism. One of the fundamental questions in genomics is, what makes a population? You can only imagine why this is so critical, because accurately describing human diversity directly impacts our understanding of genomic variation among people. In the past, scientists have incorrectly classified races as distinct biological groups, which has led to health inequities and scientific racism. Most scientists have since rejected the idea of racial and ethnic categories as discrete biological units. But much of the media still continues to portray race as rooted in biology, perpetuating the belief that race can be seen in our DNA. So the larger question is, how do we effectively and accurately communicate about the complexities of race, ancestry, and ethnicity? How are social scientists and other researchers communicating to the press and the public about the language used to describe human variation? And how could changing that language reduce scientific racism? Fortunately, today we have a social scientist and researcher and author, Dr. Dorothy Roberts, to answer some of these questions and to answer your questions for the next hour. Today's event is one in a series that features trailblazers in science communication talking about their craft with someone at NHGRI. Today it's me. Each guest is an expert in communicating about genomics across various media, from podcasting to preprints to everything in between. Dr. Roberts has communicated about every single media outlet there is, I think. Our goal with the series is to talk about different ways of communicating about the fast-paced field of genomics, to give you behind-the-scenes stories about breaking news, as well as to discuss the unique challenges and opportunities each medium can bring. We have an amazing lineup for this series. Our previous guest was Amy Harmon of the New York Times. Today we have Dorothy Roberts, and then our next guest will be Elizabeth Wayne, podcaster. The series runs through 2022. You can find details at genome.gov/GAM. And it is my pleasure today to introduce Dr. Dorothy Roberts, who is an acclaimed scholar of race, gender, and the law. She's a professor at the University of Pennsylvania and author of Fatal Invention, How Science, Politics, and Big Business Recreate Race in the 21st Century. And I have the book right here, which I read with great relish. And Killing the Black Body, Race, Reproduction, and the Meaning of Liberty, among many other works. So for the next hour, I have questions for Dr. Roberts, which I'm very eager to ask her, but we are also looking for you to submit your questions so that she can answer them for the time. So please, if you have a question, go ahead and submit it on social media with hashtag genomics in the media, or you can drop them straight into Zoom if you're logged into our Zoom platform. Into the question feature. This conversation is being recorded and will be posted later on our YouTube channel if you miss it for the next few minutes. Thank you, Dorothy, for being here and for joining us today. I will try very hard to call you Dr. Dorothy instead of Dr. call you Dr.
Dorothy. Just call me Dorothy, please.
Dorothy instead of Dr. Roberts. So let me start out with a question to kick us off, if I may, before we get to all of the wonderful things that you have to talk about. So I mentioned Fatal Invention. You've written several influential books that touch on race and genomics. And you've said that some of the reporting that you've seen in a lot of high profile press has inspired you to write that book and some of your other works. So could you start out by telling us what story you thought needed to be told based on what you saw in the press?
Yes. So this goes back to the mapping of the human genome. That's when I first got interested in contesting some of the stories I saw in the press. You know, as you know, when the human genome was mapped, there was a lot of celebration and talk about how it showed that race was not real at the genetic level. Everybody involved, Francis Collins and Craig Venter and President Clinton, they all made a point of saying this. And then right after that, I noticed these stories in the New York Times and other places about how the next step in the Human Genome Project was going to be to look for racial differences in the genes. And I was really taken aback. Nicholas Wade in particular was claiming in the New York Times that there were three principal races. Yes, here's an example of, you know, him saying on the front page of the New York Times that the next question was going to be to look for racial differences, and stated that there were three principal human races and they emerged from evolutionary pressures, as if this were a scientific fact, when I knew this was not true. And so I was really alarmed. I wanted to look into this. And so I began to investigate whether there were articles being written that stated this, and unfortunately found that, yes, there were some genetic scientists and biomedical researchers who were making claims of racial differences at the genetic level. And so I thought it was important to write a book that, first of all, highlighted that this was going on, but also contested this view, explained that race was an invented political category, gave the evidence and the history of that, explained what race really was, and countered these ideas. Like this study that claimed that its hypothesis was that Black race, independent of other factors, caused preterm births, higher rates of preterm births in Black women. And then it got a headline in the New York Times that the study pointed to genetics, when there was no way that study could have proven at all that genes were the cause of racial disparities in preterm births. And it's interesting, the New York Times in that article did interview a genetic scientist who objected that the researchers didn't look at genes, but they didn't contest the very premise of this study that race was a biological thing that could, by itself, independent of all other factors, have this impact on preterm births. That's nonsensical, actually. And so I wanted to write a book that documented what was going on and that contested this return or resurgence of the idea that race is found in our genes and could explain health disparities.
So why do you think it is so prevalent for the media to continue to talk about, you know, race-based genetics, despite having most scientists, most of the scientific community, knowing that it's not based in our DNA?
Yeah, well, first of all, I want to challenge the typical way that questions about genomics in the media and race is framed. So the question is typically, how can scientists explain their research more clearly to the public so it's not misinterpreted by the media in these racist ways or these, you know, false ways? But I do want to point out that there is a major step that that question skips, which is, why do these ideas persist in science? So, you know, so that they're not communicated to the public at all. There are two problems. I mean, one problem is the media misinterpreting genetic research and continuing to promote a false idea that race is a biological, natural division of human beings. But there is also a problem of some scientists continuing to use race as if it were a biological trait. Nicholas Wade and others were not making this up. They were actually referring to studies that were being conducted. And that study I just showed is an actual study that was published in a peer-reviewed journal. So those headlines are based on on research that continues to go on. It may be true that most scientists have rejected this view, but this research continues to be published. And I think there's also a confusion about whether race, you know, what it means that race is socially constructed. Many people think race is a biological category that is socially constructed, or race is partly biological and partly social. And I find that there are many scientific studies that confuse these terms and this way of thinking about race, and don't reject absolutely the notion that human beings are naturally divided by evolution or by some other force into races. So it's a two-pronged. One is for scientists to stop treating race as if it were a genetic category. And then the second is for scientists to do a better job at explaining to the media why race is not a biological category. And also to figure out, as you're pointing out, why there is this continual persistent obsession with treating race as if it were biological. I think that is the way that most Americans think about it. It's been embedded in science and popular culture for 400 years, at least. There's a lot of reasons why it persists. In my opinion, it persists primarily because it gives an excuse for structural racism. It seems to explain why there are these profound disparities along racial lines in our society, despite the fact that we're supposed to be a post-racial society. And so it serves, as it always has, a political purpose. This slide that you're showing now, I use to explain how the concept of race is a pre-modern concept that was invented to support the enslavement of African people, the dispossession and extermination of indigenous people by Europeans in the 1500s. And initially was a theological concept that God created the races. This made it acceptable then for Christians to enslave people because they were just following God's will. And then in the Enlightenment period, Enlightenment scientists in Europe adopted this idea that race was a natural creation. And they adopted it to support slavery and dispossession and conquest and extermination, the same reasons, and really the same basic idea that some force of nature at some point in human history or in the origins of humankind divided all human beings into racial categories. That's purely invented, but that idea persists today in new ways of explaining it scientifically. So it's a pre-modern folkloric, you know, theological idea that got imported into the Enlightenment science to justify slavery. And then genomics, or you know, the theory of genetics, inheritability, and evolution, transported it. And now we get the explanation that Nicholas Way gave, that it's due to evolutionary pressure. But it's the same basic idea that some force of nature discovered by scientists, not invented by them, discovered by scientists, divided human beings into races. It's a false idea, but it has hundreds of years of history behind it, and it continues to have political usefulness. It continues to be able to explain away deep, profound, horrible racial inequities in America that's supposed to be equal and have gotten rid of, at least by the civil rights movement, structural racism. And that's why it persists. That's what I believe is the main reason it persists.
In reading your book, I know you go through a lot of other possible population descriptors, you know, that we could use as an alternative to race. And I know that there still isn't broad consensus in the scientific community about what to replace it with. So I wonder if that's part of the challenge. You know, actually NIH just in October started funding a National Academy study that's going to be focused on this very issue to see what other population descriptors might be, you know, used instead of race. What is that part of the challenge then?
Yes. Well, yeah, part of the challenge is that biological scientists and biomedical researchers and doctors have for hundreds of years relied on race as this essential division of human beings. And in medicine, I've argued that it's used as a proxy for something that's more important, but it's a convenient proxy to use. At least that's what they say. And so it's very common for doctors to be taught that they should identify their patients by race and treat them accordingly. And also there's continues to be this almost knee-jerk categorization of people into races as if this is some absolutely essential way of identifying different populations in order to compare them to each other and figure out what's the reason for all sorts of problems. And in some ways, it's just, it's a force of habit. It's just what has been taught to the next generation of scientists and doctors, and they haven't thought about another way to do it. I really see this as a problem of a failure of imagination, because we can think of other ways of understanding human genetic variation. I mean, most, as you said, most human genetic scientists and human evolutionary biologists have figured out other ways. But one thing to point out is whatever we figure out is a social action. There is no natural population. Any population we pick, whether it's the citizens of Philadelphia or it's women or whether it's Jamaicans or, you know, the Mormons, whatever population we choose, it's going to, whether it's national or ethnic, it's going to be one that is invented. You know, the criteria, the limitations are all invented. Why did we pick this population? But these are all important questions that race tends to align altogether. So people just use it and don't think about who are you including in this group? What are the criteria for belonging to it? And if you ask that, you would see it has to be a social, historical, political definition. And so there's ethnicity, which is one possible alternative, but of course, ethnicity is an invented category as well. In an article that I co-authored, published in Science, we argued that scientists studying human genetic variation should use ancestry instead of race. Now, we acknowledge that ancestry too is constructed in the sense that how are you going to measure ancestry? How far but do you go back? If you go back far enough, all human beings are African. So you've got to figure out how far back you're going to go to isolate this population, ancestral population, but at least ancestry is actually about an individual's relationship to other individuals in their genealogical history. It's a real thing. It's a real biological relationship. And so there is more of a personal understanding of one's genomic heritage that is related to real connection and real genealogical historical connection to other human beings. Whereas race is a made up, preconceived, you know, socially constructed group. And then people figure out, well, how should we determine whether someone belongs to that group or not? But a priori, they're already imagining this made up, invented group, that the only way that you can determine whether someone belongs to it is through a social or political set of criteria. You cannot determine it biologically, whereas you can ancestry. Doesn't answer the question, but the point is, we need to end this obsession with relying on a false concept of race, and that then allows us to be more innovative and creative and honest, you know, about the populations that we're studying, that we're identifying and studying. And I'm really so excited about this NIH funded National Academies committee that's going to look at it. It's actually something that Michael Udell, Sarah Tishkoff, Rob DeSalle, and I not only advocated for in our science article, but then very recently issued a statement to the NIH, which was signed on by 70 genetic experts to do it. So we're claiming some role in this, even though we weren't cited, but we have been calling for this.
Absolutely. I know it's been a huge effort by a lot of people involved, and I know there's going to be a lot of interest in what the study finds. So we're getting a few questions for you from online, Dorothy, not Dr. Roberts. One question is, sort of related to communicating about the need to come up with different descriptors and how you do that with people who might be reluctant to even do so because of some implicit bias that they have, or, you know, or more overt racism that they might have. You know, I think especially talking about this online on social media can be especially fraught. So how have you dealt with, you know, in talking about your work, people who are somewhat hostile sometimes to exploring new ideas and being more imaginative about these entrenched historical ideas?
Yeah. And I want to say that the hostility and reluctance, a softer word, that I've encountered in giving lots and lots and lots of talks on this subject and engaging in multiple ways, including in the media, has come from lots of different places. It's lay people who don't understand what race means because they've been taught false concepts about it. From people who are white supremacists who want to cling to the biological concept of race so they can claim innate superiority and purity. But it's also come from genomic scientists and doctors who they want to hold on to the traditions that they have. And there's other reasons, there are commercial reasons for marketing why you might want to cling to these racial categories, lots of those reasons. So the one way that I've addressed it is to focus on history and the afterlives of history. So I found it very helpful to show people that these ideas come out of a history of enslavement and dispossession and genocide, that the biological concept of race was invented for a reason. You know, I like to show that Thomas Jefferson attributed the reason why Black people could not be emancipated and couldn't participate in his new democracy that was supposed to be based on principles of equality and freedom and tolerance and liberty. You know, he blamed the differences that nature hath made that, excused this continuing atrocity of slavery in the United States. And then I like to show how we can trace the perpetuation of these ideas through different eras in the United States and the way in which scientists have adapted their way of explaining race, keeping it as a biological category, but is still explaining it or trying to prove it, it using the latest theories and methods and technologies, and then show how it's embedded in some medical technologies today. So in the form of race correction, for example. And I find that that people, it's enlightening to some people who are open-minded to see the origins of the ideas that they've been using, the categories they've been using, the concepts they've been using to point out not only that it's rooted in slavery, but that there's a continuing legacy of it. I do find that sometimes if you just point to history, it's easy for people to say, well, that was the past. In fact, the term scientific racism is an interesting term because many people, when they hear that, they think, oh, you're talking about, you know, during the slavery era, you're talking about eugenics, or you're talking about the Nazis. That was the past. We don't have scientific racism anymore. And there's a funny way, well, disturbing way, I think, how by being able to say, I'm not like them, that means I don't have to question how I'm using race in my research. And that's why I want to show not just what happened in the past, but how it reverberates in science today. And this, and not to say, well, you're doing this because you're a racist, but to say, if you're not a racist, why do you want to use a concept that was developed to support racism? And most people, if they really think about it, they have to question what they're doing if they want to claim, I'm not racist, I'm not doing this for racist reasons. Then you have to examine, why are you using a concept that was invented for racist reasons? So that's another technique I use. Also, what's I think has been really helpful lately is research showing the harms, especially to Black Americans. A lot of racial research focuses on Black people. I think we get to be treated as if we are a peculiar race that should be distinct from all others. And that plays out today in many medical technologies that literally treat Black patients differently than all other human beings, automatically and categorically. And so showing that you cannot claim this is beneficial to Black people, which is often the excuse for it, and showing the harms, the concrete harms to people that come out of it, I think that's helpful as well, at least to get people to think about, how can I continue to justify using these concepts now that I know that they're rooted in a history of slavery and colonialism and dispossession and genocide. And now that I can see how they have been transmuted into, you know, in new forms into science today, I have this evidence that it's not a true portrayal of the human species. And I have this evidence that it's harming the people I'm claiming to help. I think that that at least gets people to think about it. Another strategy I use is to collaborate with genomic scientists who often are going to be believed more than I am. You know, there's also this tendency by some people to say, well, what do you know about genetics? You know, you're a legal scholar and a sociologist, you know? And I, my response often is, well, what do you know about race? You know, that you obviously don't understand what structural racism is and the history of racism in science, but Yes, here's an example of that article in Science I mentioned that I co-authored with a historian of science and two genetic scientists. One, Sarah Tishkoff, who's one of the leading experts on genetic variation in Africa, and one of my colleagues at Penn. And oh, I'm so sorry, that was me. reminder, sorry about that. I find that co-authoring with genetic scientists helps in a number of ways. It helps to give more authority to what I'm saying. And it also helps us to explain the knowledge that each of us has. I think Dr. Tishkoff will admit, she said that I've taught her a lot about what race is. And we work well together with her explanation of the vast amounts of genetic diversity in Africa, which absolutely blows away the idea that there is a biological Black race. There's more genetic diversity on the continent of Africa than there is in the rest of humanity. So the idea that Black people are a genetically homogeneous race makes absolutely no sense. It's totally unscientific. And so her research helps to support my points about the history of the invention of race and how it has continued, persisted in the centuries since then. This is an example, another example of a collaboration between me and Dr. Jonathan Metzl, who is a psychiatrist and a sociologist at Vanderbilt University and helped to create the idea of structural competency, which we argue is what medical students should be taught instead of just cultural competency, which tends to focus on the patient and what's wrong with the patient, reinforce stereotypes about patients. We argue there should be structural competency that doctors should, and I would say this is true for genomic scientists as well, should be taught to be structurally competent so that they understand how structural racism and other structural inequalities affect people's health. And so we wrote a piece that was in the AMA, a Journal of Ethics, about his work in structural competency, my work in structural racism, and again, put it together as a way to improve medical education in the United States. You know, there was a study that was published in 2016 that showed that a substantial number of white medical students and residents at a major medical school in the United States believe false ideas about race and racial biological differences, like Black people have thicker skin than white people, and Black people have less sensitive nerve endings. And they conducted the study to try to figure out why it is that it's well documented that Black patients are less likely to receive any pain medication than white patients for the same painful injuries, or to receive less pain treatment. And whether we're talking about bone fractures or pain after C-sections or little children in emergency rooms who are in pain from appendicitis. And they linked these false biological concepts to this mistreatment of Black patients. And I think, and this goes to this next slide, that medical schools that are teaching biological concepts of race and teaching students that they need to treat their patients according to race only reinforces the view that there are these categorical racial differences between people that should affect diagnosis and treatment. And if you already have these really disparaging stereotypes in your head. And when you come to medical school, this only reinforces it. And so this is an example of an article that I contributed to, but was really led by students, medical students at the Perelman School of Medicine at Penn, on looking at the way in which medical school curricula reinforce these false biological concepts of race and proposing how to get rid of them in the curriculum. So another example of an interdisciplinary project that gets at these really basic, false and damaging ideas about race that persist in science and medicine. And there's lots we can do to fight scientific racism. I have focused a lot on ending this false idea about human biological difference and unity, the idea that human beings are naturally divided into races, and therefore races are essentially biologically distinguishable, and therefore scientists should be looking for the differences as a way to address the inequalities we see in our society. You know, that's not only a false idea about the human species and our humanity, our common humanity, as well as our differences, but it's also a powerful way to obscure the structural inequalities that persist and a barrier to social change and a barrier to good science and medicine, because it leads to this sloppy, you know, I mean, we could focus on the sloppiness and the dangers of continuing to use race as a biological variable instead of coming together in interdisciplinary ways to create, you know, think about how can we design research, including genetic research, that takes into account structural inequalities instead of obscuring them. I think that's the challenge that we should have. You know, that's what we should have done with the mapping of the human genome. I wish there were a headline in the New York Times that's instead of saying, I don't want to just pick up the New York Times, but you know, any newspaper or media, instead of saying the next phase of the human genome project will be to address the genetic differences between races, if instead it said, the next phase of the Human Genome Project is to address structural inequalities and figure out what is the relationship of genes to those structural inequalities without, and let me emphasize this, because there's some, you know, some people take that as saying, oh, let's find the genetic reasons for structural inequalities. I'm not saying that at all. I'm saying if we're going to study human genetics, let's figure out a way to do it that doesn't perpetuate false biological ideas and that does address structural inequalities. That doesn't, I think right now too much genomic research functions as obscuring structural inequalities. How can we design scientific research that addresses structural inequalities? How can science be anti-racist? That's, to me, that's such an exciting question that we should be looking at. You know, there's so many examples in race correction, for example, when finally we're starting to see the groups that determine the standards say we should stop adjusting automatically for race. And then you see scientists say, okay, we're going to stop. If we have to stop that, how are we going to measure kidney function? Or how are we going to, you know, measure pain, you know, the treatment for pain, if we don't rely on race? Yes, let's figure that out. And yes, here's some examples of race correction, how now we're seeing research. And look at these studies, they're just coming out in the last couple of years, you know, that are finally looking at, is it actually helpful to correct for race, which, you know, again, rooted in slavery, for us to continue doing this, and finding out, lo and behold, oh, this harms Black patients. Mm. You know, I could have told you that without the study, but it's helpful to have the study. And then we are starting to see these corrections ending in healthcare systems and in the standards. And then the scientists, no longer able to rely on race, are doing helpful research that looks at what should the equations be? How can we have a calculator that actually does a better job at diagnosing kidney disease or diagnosing or determining whether a pregnant patient can have a vaginal birth after a C-section? You know, these important questions that have been determined by race, instead of doing the innovative, high quality research, you know, that we should be doing to come up with helpful, truly helpful treatments and diagnoses that would help to end health inequities.
Well, we're getting a couple of questions from people watching about, you know, because there are certain health conditions correlated with genomic variants. So how do you, if you're a part of a population that tends to have a certain genomic variant, you know, how do you factor that into your health decisions? You know, how do you group yourself?
Yes, well, and group yourself by the genetic variant, that's important. Mm-hmm. You know, that's another thing. When the human genome was mapped, the argument for putting all the millions of dollars into it was, oh, it's going to help us now have a new age of, you know, more accurate diagnoses, because doctors will scan the genomes of patients and determine what their genetic makeup is, and then be able to target medications to them more accurately, that sort of thing. Well, that hasn't happened. Instead, these backward race adjustments continue. And if there is a genetic variant that's so important to determining the health status or predicting the health of a patient, then that's what should be used, not race. Race is a bad proxy for that. I do not want a doctor assuming anything about some really important genetic variant that I might have because I'm Black. No, tell me if I have it. And you know, there are studies that show, for example, that family history is a better predictor than the GWAS studies that have been looking for the genes that can predict certain common diseases. And I also want to make the point that genes themselves don't determine health outcomes, rarely. I mean, there's some that are highly predictive, but that's not the case for most common diseases. There's lots of other factors that are really important. I believe that what's important with respect to race and health is racism, is the impact of racism on people's health. And that is not about a genetic variant. I would venture to say that the most important aspect of race with respect to health inequities is structural racism, not anything about the prevalence of genetic variants in one group or another. And I mean, I'm absolutely convinced of that. And so, yes, this is, you know, part of the title of this program is about language. And mm-hmm. I think that there has been a shift in language about the causes of health inequities from a biological, racial perspective that sort of knee-jerk looks for, well, what's the genetic explanation for why, you know, Black people have higher rates of COVID infection and death? And there were viewpoints published immediately that said, oh, we must look for the genetic explanation for this. Instead, the language that's coming out of both biomedical, anthropological, sociological, public health literature is the role of structural racism. So we're sick of racism, literally. The idea that racism gets embodied or gets under the skin, and studies that are looking at how that happens, those are important ways that the language is changing. And I think it's almost a mantra now among some of us who are addressing structural racism and its impact on health, that racism, not race, is the risk factor. I think that's such a helpful term to use. Racism, not race, is the risk factor. It is not some innate trait of Black people that causes this higher rate of infection and death from COVID or multiple other kinds of diseases. It's the impact of structural racism on people's health. And that doesn't mean that genetics aren't important to health or that we shouldn't study the impact of genetics, but genetics does not explain structural inequalities. It doesn't explain health inequities. If we're talking about health inequities, you know, racial disparities in health, you know, the ways in which Black people who are, as I said, the most genetically diverse group of people in the world, both because of the genetic diversity on the continent of Africa and because of all the mixture that's gone on in what we, you know, how we define African-American or Black in America as having any African ancestry. So, of course, you can have more ancestry from other racial groups and still be considered Black, which is another huge problem in treating Black people as if they're a, you know, homogeneous genetic category. But that's what it doesn't even make sense to say that we should, you know, it's genetic differences that are causing these big gaps in health. There's so much more evidence, and it's much more plausible to say that it's caused by the impact of being categorized as Black because of the political implications of that for where you live and your access to healthcare and your access to high quality housing and employment. And, you know, the likelihood you'll be incarcerated. Yeah. All of that is a far more plausible hypothesis than the one I showed before, that Black race by itself, you know, independent of all these other factors I just mentioned, is the cause of some racial difference in a health outcome. So I think that genomic scientists can do a better job of explaining that to the media and figuring out in their own research designs how not to perpetuate a biological concept of race and how to grapple with the impact of structural racism. And then the media can do a better job of publishing that kind of research. That's number one. This fascination with simple genetic explanations for social outcomes, it gets so much attention from the media instead of the the research that is looking at how structural racism impacts health. And that's then a role that scientists and the media can play together in order to promote the stories that and the research that addresses the impact of racism and innovative ways of thinking about genetics. I'd also say that, you know, again, I'm not saying genetics isn't important to health. I'm not saying that genetics can't be helpful in creating cures. I know that, for example, friends of mine who've had breast cancer have taken advantage of Penn Medicine of their way of determining the genetics of the cancer itself to help to treat the tumor more effectively and determine what's the right treatment for it. That doesn't depend on the patient's race. It depends on the cancer, testing the cancer and developing treatments for the cancer. Where racism comes in is when Black people don't have access to those high quality, newfangled ways of, you know, very effective treatments because of inequities in health insurance and other ways that we unjustly distribute healthcare in America. So it's not to mention, there's also a study conducted at Penn by Katrina Armstrong that showed that Black women were far less likely to be counseled on or to be referred to genetic counseling by their doctors for the BRCA 1 and 2 gene, even when they had a family history of breast cancer and other indicators that they might have the gene. Well, why is that? Because of this idea, this goes to the question you were asking me before, that the genes are connected to racial groups. And the idea that white women would have the BRCA 1 and 2 gene, but Black women wouldn't, which is just not true. And so she and her team found that white women were four times more likely to be referred for genetic counseling when they had the same indicators as Black women, or the Black women had the same indicators as the white women. And so these false concepts of race and genetics can lead, once again, to harms to patients. And we have to be aware of those, and you know, that should be part of what genomic scientists are saying to the public and to doctors, as well as the advances that genetics can make in terms of new therapies. You know, we want to make sure these therapies are equitably distributed, and linking genes to race does not help at that at all. It doesn't, even with sickle cell anemia, which people think falsely, you know, is a Black disease. That's not true. White people can have the trait too. They're less likely to than Black people. But that's not a way to determine who should be tested for it or who should get treatment for it. As far as I'm concerned, linking sickle cell anemia to Black people has led to racism against Black people. We know it's led to employment discrimination, insurance discrimination, and many, many Black people with sickle cell disease have pointed out how they've been rejected for treatment for pain because of stereotypes about Black people not experiencing pain or being drug seekers, and they have not gotten adequate pain treatment, and also have the funding for sickle cell disease is far less than the funding for diseases that are associated with white people. So once again, I just don't see the argument that, or I don't see evidence for the argument that thinking about genetics in racial terms helps Black people or anybody. It doesn't at all. Yeah. It's not the right category or variable to use to understand human genetic variation or to develop cures based on that understanding.
Yeah, I this hour's gone by so quickly, Dorothy. I just want to, we really have about five minutes left. Okay. And we do continue to get a lot of questions about the crux of what you're saying. You know, should we stop using race, you know, in public health as an indicator? Should we replace that with genetic ancestry or some other sort of proxy? Yeah. And then one question that I had that's related, I think one thing I learned from your book is that it seems like when you do focus on race, it masks you to other data that you overlook because you're so focused on race. You know, I think you mentioned the cancer variation, you know, between Black women and white women, and that so much of it, you know, was actually just a matter of access to healthcare.
Yeah.
Statistics that people were looking at wasn't about race at all. It was actually just about socioeconomic status
or
history of structural racism instead. Yeah. So I wonder, you know, if there's something that you know, in the last few minutes that we have, if there's, you know, that's, if there are tips that you would have, you know, for genomicists, because, you know, genomicists have such a wide range of expertise. You know, we do have genomicists who are social scientists, who are data scientists, you know, in what that you would propose that they keep in mind when they're looking at this sort of data.
Yes. Okay. So first of all, the first thing to keep in mind is what race is and what it isn't. So it is not a natural division of human beings that scientists can discover, you know, that is created in nature. It is an invented political social grouping. And I think that's just important to keep in mind, because that helps you then to say, well, how am I using it in my research? Am I using it as if it were a social category, or am I incorrectly using it as if it were a biological category? So that's one step. The other is to ask whether you're studying racism or not. If you're studying racism, then I think race is, as a social category, as a classification system that we still use in the United States and it's used globally, that does have an impact on people's well-being. And so there, used with the correct definition, it does make sense to have it as a variable in research to determine, you know, to document racism. First of all, I think that's important. If we do away with race altogether in scientific research, we won't be documenting the way in which racism continues to impact people's lives. And so I think it's important for racism. I like to say, I don't think it's too simplistic. Yes, use race if the point of your research is to document and address racism, but don't use it if you are treating it as if it's a biological variable, because it isn't. Okay. So, but also remember that race isn't the only category that affects people's health or well-being or whatever the purpose of the study is. Race intersects with class, you know, poverty or wealth, with education, with gender, you know, with lots of other aspects of both our identities, but also with the way our society is structured that affect every aspect of our society. You know, so whatever you're studying, it's not just about race, it intersects with others as well. Although race and racism do explain a lot, you know, in America. I think that we don't want to ignore that in our research at all. And then I would also, another thing I would say is to acknowledge that these racist ideas persist in science today and not refer to scientific racism as if it were a thing of the past and only the result of misinterpretations of science by white supremacists or ignorant, you know, media, that some of the reason why the media persists in reporting these ideas is because they're reporting actual studies that have been published by scientists. And so how can scientists expose and eliminate these racist ideas about biological differences that have been rooted in science since the time of slavery? And how can scientists ask questions and design research that's anti-racist? You know, that I've heard, you know, when I say things like that, sometimes scientists say, oh, but we're neutral. We can't, you know, well, no, you're not neutral if you're studying race. You're not, you cannot be neutral. You are studying a political system. So you can't be neutral about it. And guess what? Science hasn't been neutral. It's for centuries, it has perpetuated racist ideas. Dominant science has perpetuated these ideas. So you can't be neutral as a scientist. You have to take the stand of, I am going to be anti-racist, especially if you are claiming to speak on social policies having to do with race and racism. And so how do we do that? And again, that's the exciting project for genomics and race, right? To me, not going backward and just adding more armor to this false idea, you know, with some evolutionary theory that sounds just like God created the races, you know, but how do we collaborate interdisciplinarily with media, and I should have mentioned this before, so I'm glad I have a last word to say this, and with people in their communities. How do you collaborate with the communities that you are saying you're helping and that you're, you know, getting research subjects from? That's another topic, the ethics of genomic research, but true collaboration where there is absolute participation by the people in communities that are being studied and recruited to contribute their genetic data. You know, what are you doing to end the structural racism that is often oppressing the very communities that are now becoming, so you know, the sources of genetic research? And the argument that, well, in the future our research is going to help these communities, I don't think that's good enough. It has to be, how can we show benefit now? And the scientists can't make this up. They have to hear it from the research participants and the communities they come from. So all of that is, I think, the challenge for how we address scientific racism in America today.
Thank you, Dorothy. I know this is going to be, this is just a tiny drop in a huge ongoing conversation. But I think you've very eloquently, you know, presented so many fascinating ideas today. I know we have a lot of questions from people, and I think we'll just have to take more of those online at some point in the future. I did want to mention too, just for our audience, in case they don't know, you know, NHGRI is hosting a History of Eugenics Symposium actually in December, December 2nd and 3rd, and that fits right into your framework, Dorothy, of using history as a nice way to address current inequities and current racism. You know, eugenics, you know, was not only focused on racism, but ableism, sexism, yeah, homophobia, quite a few things wrapped up in there under the guise of science. And inaccurate science. So in addition to that, we do have our next speaker for Genomics in the Media. That will be January 20th. That's going to be Elizabeth Wayne, who is a professor of chemistry at Carnegie Mellon University, and she is also the co-host of the PhD Divas podcast. So she will she'll be talking about podcasting. I know, Dorothy, you know a lot about that too. So maybe you can submit some questions for that one. Thank you so much, Dorothy, for joining us today. I can't tell you how excited we were and just honored to have you.
This
conversation was recorded, so we'll post it online afterwards for people to watch. And I'm really excited to see all the other great things you'll be doing.
Thank you. I appreciate this opportunity to address this audience, and I look forward to collaborating with you in the future.
Thank you so much.